trying to keep these this series of faculty lectures on schedule, and it's a real pleasure to introduce Sonny Palmer to you today. Sonny Palmer joined our faculty last year, and he brings to our faculty the greatest amount of big building expertise on our architecture faculty. And it's a kind of expertise that's very hard for us, been very hard for us in the past to hire. So we're very proud to have him as with his special area as an addition to our faculty. He graduated first with a Bachelor of Architecture degree from Texas A&M. He practiced 1 or 2 years and then went off to Columbia University to get a master's specializing in educational facilities. So he as well brings that educational facilities expertise to our faculty. As a matter of fact, he graduated in the same educational facilities program at Columbia University that Marvin Rosenman graduated with. After that experience at Columbia, he was a project designer with Harrison and Abramovitz in New York City. He was then partner of the firm in Washington of Brooks Barr Graber White and Partners, which was first a Texas firm with a Washington office, and he headed up that Washington operation, became a partner in the firm. After that, he was a partner in the firm of Davis, Smith, and Palmer, Incorporated, architects in engineering, planning, and interior design, Reston, Virginia, St. Louis, Missouri, and New York City. From 1974 to the present, he's been an independent designer and writer, and has co-authored the book Planning the Office Landscape. He's been programmed expert in the field of office landscape at all kinds of seminars and meetings across the country. This experience that Sonny had this past summer adds another facet to his great experience he brings to this college. Sonny Palmer.
You don't hold against me the fact that I went to Texas A&M.
Bob Probst, who is an independent research person in Ann Arbor, Michigan, has done a lot of work with Herman Miller. In fact, most people think he's associated with Herman Miller. Once made a comment that he thought that all people could be divided into two groups. The first group are persons that don't have enough information, and the second group being those persons that have too much information. Today is a little unique because normally I place myself in the former category, not having enough information. Today, I think probably I have too much. The time we spent in Indonesia, we being my wife and I, we took something like 1,200 slides. I'm not going to show you all of those. And consequently, or ironically, I suppose, they all came out good. So we had a lot of trouble in narrowing this presentation down to something that's, let's say, worth dealing with. Now, you probably have a problem today in that you're going to be suffering information overload. I would like to show quite a few slides. I'm going to show them rather quickly so that cover the various topics that I would like to. And please feel free, if the time goes on, I hope it does, if you want to leave, please go ahead and leave. I'll understand. However, I'll throw a fishhook out for you. All of the nude Balinese photographs are at the end of the show.
Let's get going.
If I can have that first projector. Would someone mind closing the door, please? Is that light all the way on the projector?
The purpose of our going to Indonesia was to fulfill some contractual arrangements with the Asian Development Bank. Now, technically, I was under contract with a firm in Indonesia by the name of Resources Management International. That's a technicality. The firm was used basically for payroll, providing office space and that sort of thing. And technically, we were, in fact, under the jurisdiction of the Asian Development Bank. Now, our task there was this. In Sulawesi, which is one of the islands of Indonesia, there is a university called Universitas Hasanuddin. It's been there for about 20 years. And our task was to look at the situation and see if we would recommend to the bank that they provide loan money for upgrading that particular university and increasing the size of it. In a nutshell, our tasks were these. First, to look at the academic plan. And I might say that when we first started at the beginning of the summer, the university had 9 colleges. At the end of the summer, they took our advice and reduced that to 5 colleges, and in January, they're going to 4. What they had is a lot of duplication, and by simplifying and streamlining the operation, we were able to accomplish that. The second was to look at the curricular plan. In Indonesia, most of the universities are laid out on the European system, and the students coming out of universities have a great deal of trouble getting into American universities and master's and doctoral programs. So curricular was a major planning involvement. University enrollment, now that sounds like a silly kind of task, but what we had to do was look at the manpower situation in all of Eastern Indonesia. And out of that, determining and projecting some kind of enrollment for the university. What we recommended is that in 1982, they increase the enrollment to 10,000, and later, probably 1987, they increase it to 15,000. From a physical side, there's a master plan involved for the new university. Incidentally, there is a university there now with buildings, etc. The total university in Toto is being moved to a new site. So there's a master plan involved. Facility plan is a little misleading. What we did was establish guidelines for the buildings that were to be built. There will be a team of architects coming on site in February of this coming year, and they will work there for 5 years doing the detailed planning of the university. Implementation schedule, I've touched on that. The two target dates, 1982, 1987, and of course, how much does this all cost? Obvious question from the bank. For what it's worth in Indonesia, the total cost, including all facilities and upgrading the faculty, is running right at $42 million. Faculty upgrading is one of the key elements. And what that amounts to is taking the various people in the university that at this point either have only an undergraduate degree or a master's degree, and making arrangements for those persons to upgrade their education, mostly in Australia, the United States, Canada, and certain countries in Europe. So
essentially, that was our task. Now, if I get the right button, and I didn't.
To do all of this, there was a team involved. In fact, there was an overlapping team. In this case, you can read this, it says architect. That was my role, and I had a counterpart, Professor Undop, who teaches at the university. And then the various other people, an international economist, a doctor, engineer, agricultural expert, put it together. There were support groups. Now, support varied anywhere from translators to the drivers for our various vehicles. In addition to that, the team as a group responded to a small review board made up of the rector or president of the university, the vice rector of the university, and one member from the brokerage firm that I mentioned, Resources Management International, prior to final reports going to both the Asian Development Bank and the Indonesian Ministry of Higher Education. Now, this was the way the thing was set up in the beginning, and theoretically it was to have run this way. What really happened was the representative from RMI, because of other responsibilities, did not participate. The two rectors moved down and became a part of the team. So this step, while it shows up on the charts as happening that way, it really did not. It became a team working directly with both the bank and the ministry. Time-wise, the schedule went something like this. I came, there's 3.5 months roughly. I was the first person there. And about 6 weeks later, the international economist came. This Dr. Peter Frank from the University of Syracuse. About 2 months into the project, three consultants came at the same time. Dr. Neil Galt for medicine, who is dean of the medical school at the University of Minnesota. Dr. Stuart Johnson, who is just retired as dean of the University of Raleigh as an engineer. Dr. Bill McGee, who is an agricultural expert and a freelance consultant working out of New York City. And later, toward the end, two more experts, Dr. Patterson from University of Buffalo, who is vice president for academic affairs, and Dr. Dave Kaiser from University of Indiana in Bloomington, who is library expert. Now, the other person I mentioned is Dr. Walter Stone, who is with the firm in Jakarta. And his involvement was sporadic until the end, and then his task really began to really put the report to bed. Now, you notice I mentioned doctor all the way through here. Everybody was a doctor except me, except in Indonesia. And in Indonesia, if you have a master's degree, and what happens is, in front of your name, you get DRS, which means you have a master's degree, but you're called doctor. So all of us were doctors. These bona fide, and I by fluke. You might be interested to know that the Indonesian's status is very important. If you have a PhD, in front of your name, you get capital D, little R, for doctor. If you're a medical doctor, you get little d, little r for doctor. And if you're a master's, have a master's or an MFA, you get little d, little r, little s. But we're all called doctors. Now, in essence, that's the way the team was set up. That was the involvement of the team. The final product of the team is a 7-volume report, which I have yet to receive my copy of, but it is an incredibly detailed report. And I assume that it's because of the mail between Indonesia and the U.S. that I have not received it. In any case, for what it's worth, this was the first report of this kind, which went to the Asian Development Bank, which had no changes made to it. And I'm very proud of that, because when you consider this group of people, none of us knew each other before we started working. We produced 7 volumes,
and then the bank accepts them as is. That's quite a feat. Now, probably a lot of people in the room are not even aware of what Indonesia actually is, except out there somewhere.
Indonesia is this group of islands right in here, located about halfway between Australia and, let's say, India, or the Thailand Peninsula. As you can see, or you can't see here, but this is the camera. New York is about here. It's now roughly, say, 4 o'clock in New York in the afternoon. Jakarta, which is about here, is 4 o'clock in the morning. What that means is Jakarta and New York are just about perfectly halfway around the world. In fact, you can fly either direction for the same price.
If we look at the country a little more closely,
you can get a better picture of what it is. Indonesia is made up of some 13,000 islands, 3,000 plus or minus inhabited. This is the Thailand Peninsula, which comes down this way. Singapore is right here at the end of this peninsula. This large island to the left, Sumatra, and then you move to Java, one of the major islands. A series of small islands, Sumbawa, Sumba, Flores, Timor, and in the middle, Bali, which we've all heard of. The island that we were involved in is Sulawesi, this thing that Indonesians say looks like an orchid. I never did figure that one out, but that's what they say. Kalimantan, or this portion of Kalimantan, which is better known probably as Borneo. The Moluccas are this whole string of small islands through here, and if you're familiar with the incidents that happened in Holland about a year ago with the train and the pigs and so forth, those were Indonesians from this area in Moluccas. And to the far east, Irian Jaya, which is shares the island of New Guinea. Now, most people do not realize the size of Indonesia. If you look at the easternmost city, which is about here, Jayapura, and the westernmost city, which is up here, which is Banda Aceh, the distance between those two cities is equal to the distance from London to Baghdad, or from Mexico City to Juneau, Alaska. So it's a very large country that is basically primarily all islands. Now, because of all the islands and the various cultures, there's a primary or base language of Bahasa Indonesian, which is more or less a manufactured language. It's also one of the youngest languages that we have. It was developed in 1920. But most of the people, while they speak Bahasa Indonesian, they speak their local languages. And the local languages, from one end to the other, there are 24 distinct languages and no telling how many dialects. So consequently, take two groups, like the Sarajanese in this area and the Buginese in this area. If they speak their native dialects, they cannot speak to each other. Now, English is a second language, or let's say it is the professional language. All of the libraries have English books in them. Most of your professionals speak English, and a lot of people in shops and so forth speak a little English. A little bit about the makeup of Indonesia. It's curious. It's 85% Muslim, yet it's not a Muslim country. The other 15% are made up of about 12% Christian, the remaining 3% being Hindu, Buddhist, and animist.
When we flew to Indonesia, we flew first to Jakarta on the island of Java, which is here. Jakarta is an enormous city, some 700 square miles of land. It's the largest city east of Calcutta, west of Los Angeles, and south of Tokyo. It's about the same size as both Singapore and Hong Kong put together, or Sydney. There
approximately 135,000 people in Indonesia, about 135 million people in Indonesia, about 80 million of those live on this one island, which is not the largest island.
So, when you talk about density in that part of the world,
Java is extremely dense. Some of the other islands not dense at all. Now, I would like to start showing some of the slides that we took, beginning with Java, because this is where we came first, flying into Jakarta. Jakarta, if you can see this is the ocean front that you see here on the north side of the island. The city, which is within this dashed red line, really rambles all over. But basically, the city is made up of pieces. This piece here being the old Dutch portion, this being the Chinese portion, these being the downtown and the new development. The airport is out here, and Kebayoran, which is the new area out here and where we had our offices for that short period of time we were in. Jakarta. May I have the other projector, please?
Now,
when we start through these other, can you back up?
Never mind.
When we start through these slides, I would like you, as I said earlier, go very quickly. This is the Textual Museum. Incidentally, these may not appear to be in any fashion order, they actually are, and I hope you'll see the order as we move through. This is the Textual Museum in Jakarta. Not only is it filled with many incredibly antique pieces of fabric, but it's a nice building. And I have never seen windows quite in that detail, so I threw this in here. This is, moving on, is the teak factory. You see the fall here, Textual Museum, the teak factory, where people are actually making batiks. Now, I don't know if you're familiar how batiks are made, but basically you take a piece of fabric, put wax on one side, turn it over, put this wax in exactly the same pattern on the opposite side, stick it in dye, and everything is dyed except where you have the wax. These people here are putting finishing touches on it by hand. The previous photograph, they were using a thing called a chalk, which is dipped in the wax up on the piece of cloth. This person is carving a head for a puppet. And now we have puppets and batiks coming together. I think you can see that in some of these fabrics, if you're not familiar with batiks, how many times a various piece of fabric must be waxed, dipped, the wax washed out, new wax put on, re-dipped, on and on to get the various colors. There's an interesting story behind these puppets. The puppets are used primarily to tell various myths and stories related to things like Aesop's fables that we've heard of here. A group of sociologists in doing some studies in Indonesia found a very curious thing about the puppets. There are 75 characters within the puppet group, and all of them are designed to fit a particular kind of personality. Consequently, every child growing up in Indonesia has the possibility of identifying with one of the puppets. And in most cases, the children choose a particular puppet as their kind of hero. The result of that is, according to the sociologists and psychologists that were doing these studies, is that almost no one in Indonesia has an inferiority complex. The reason being that they have a model. And in all the people that we met in Indonesia, I have to admit that I never met a person who, like I said, had that kind of complex. This is another puppet closer up. The carving begins to show up everywhere. This is on an old building. This is the ceiling, all teak. And this is bamboo scaffolding on the outside of a new building. Our run. In fact, our office looked into that. curious. I took this photograph, and before I could talk to the camera to take a second photograph, the scaffolding was filled with people wanting a photograph taken. Indonesia has the largest fleet of sailing ships still operating in the world. And this is the harbor area, which is about here on the map. And this is where the sailing ships dock. The sailing ships are still made today. You'll see them under construction a little later. They're made as they were how long ago. They come in two sizes, 100 metric tons, which most of these are, and one about half that size of 45 metric tons. People live on the ships. They sail all over Indonesia and everywhere else in the islands, basically delivering cargo. And when they load them, they load them. As you can see, the ship is down to just literally a few inches above the sinking. And it doesn't matter if they load it with wood, in this case, or if they load it with rice flour, they load them the same way. And they unload them coming down a plank only a few inches wide by hand. This is moving into the old duck section. This happens to be the last operable Dutch bridges or drawbridges existing in Jakarta. You can't cross it anymore. It's like a walk over it. You can't drive over it. But it's identical for those of you that have been following through some of that are still watered there. On top of the bridge, like this, the woman with all the baskets would not let us take her photograph. Although the kid on the left, you can't take a photograph without children constantly getting in your way. Underneath the bridge, people actually live in this. Poverty is a real problem in Indonesia. The difference between Indonesia and some other countries is while there is poverty, there is virtually no hunger. We saw no one throughout all our travels. We're hungry. The reason being that there's so much food. Now, this is a canal, one of the old Dutch canals. That guy on the moon was actually a dugout boat. It kind of reminds me of the Cuyahoga River, in that you probably could set it on fire. These are some of the old Dutch buildings. A lot of these are being renovated now and made into offices, warehouses, whatever. This is the main railroad station in Jakarta, probably in the 20s. And this is the oldest church still existing in Indonesia. It's actually a Portuguese. The outside of it is extremely simple and plain, but as you can see, the inside is extremely ornate. Now, this is curious. Indonesia, Portuguese church, and right to the right is a Chinese choir singing Baptist hymns. This is another Dutch building in the Dutch area. A cannon, and if you look at the end of it very closely, somebody has a sense of humor. Out in this area, close to Minting, is a park called Taman Mini, which literally means small or little in Indonesia. And in this park, which is not completed at this time, the Indonesian government is reproducing all of the various traditional houses and architecture that exist throughout Indonesia. The houses you see here from the Bataks, which are up in Sumatra. I'd like for you to look at these closely because you'll see a similarity between the Bataks and the Torajas, which we'll look at in a few minutes. Even though they're many, many miles apart, the architecture is very similar. Ornamentation, they can use the same colors. Notice the reeds wrapped away with wire bands. from Sumatra, the island of Sumatra. This is a ship's clock. If you use your imagination a little closely, there is a ship there. We were very fortunate to find this. These are not made anymore. In fact, they haven't been made for some 50 years. So we would guess this one is probably 80 years old, something like that. They're incredibly beautiful. They're all woven. So the patterns you see are literally woven into it. It's not just vegetable dyes. If you're interested in these, I understand there's a shop in New York City that has them for several thousand dollars a piece. Fortunately, we didn't get anything like that. This is Fred. Fred is from a piece of sculpture from Irian Jaya, on the other end of Indonesia. And his buddy Sarah. This kind of carving is becoming more and more rare as people stop carving and start working in various lumber mills. For those of you that get to New York, the New York Museum of the Metropolitan Museum, donated by Nelson Rockefeller, has a lot of artifacts from Irian Jaya, and it's certainly worth seeing. This is a view of Jakarta from our window of our hotel. You're basically looking down this freeway here, which is off to the right. And what you see there, which is pointed out on the map, are a string of tall buildings, all international type hotels, office buildings, and that kind of thing. And to either side, camp walks. Now, moving from Jakarta up through the mountains towards Bandung, this is the kind of thing you see. Bandung is about 2,000 feet above sea level. It's incredibly cool. In fact, the Dutch tried to move the capital of Bandung into Indonesia without no part of it. Very curious about the Indonesians. When the temperature drops below 75, they are cold and bring out their sweaters. Tea plantations along the way with flowers. This is the summer palace of Sukarno, the previous president of the country. A cement factory near Bandung. Bandung is completely polluted. It's an industrial city. Closer shot of a factory. You can imagine people working in a place like this. And in Bandung is a very old hotel called the Savoy Pullman. Built by the Dutch in about 1915. It's an incredible place. If you ever get to this part of the world, for God's sakes, go see this hotel, because if for no other reason, they have the same identical china that they originally did. All the upholstery on the seats is original, and it's in good condition, even the beds. And when you rent a room there, you don't get a room, but you get like six rooms. And the price is reasonable. A view out the window. Got a lot of these flying out. But in the distance you can see a volcano. Bandung is located between two volcanoes, and the city is laid out on a grid that relates to those two volcanoes. Incidentally, all of these little dots here indicate volcanoes on the island to give you some idea of how many volcanoes. This is a Beja, a three-wheel penny bike that's used in most of Indonesia. You do not find them in Jakarta. The traffic is so congested in Jakarta that they are no longer used. This is ITB, or the Institute of Technology Bandung, which is by far the best university in Indonesia and also the oldest. For many years, they've had an arrangement two universities here in the U.S., so all of their faculty has constantly come to the U.S. and gone back with upgrading and so forth. Their equipment there is outstanding. One thing about the Indonesian architecture, this building on the left, which is under construction, that's the kind of thing you see. Brick, concrete, and then they come back and plaster the thing like the one on the right. So underneath the one on the right, wagons parked outside of Bangalore on the way up to one of the radios. This is now the radio station. I have no idea what it was in the beginning, except a very neat building. And volcano in the distance, bamboo down in the valley. And for those of you that have never looked into a volcano, this is looking into one. Big deal, you say. I had never been on top of a volcano before, and this one is active, by the way. The smell is just unbelievable. I dare say you can stay there more than 30 minutes because of the sulfur fumes. So it's only foolish tourists that go up there. Now,
flip the slide here.
Moving to the island of Sulawesi, and the city which we were in most of the time, Ujamhandam, which is here, is in the southern portion of Sulawesi. Sulawesi breaks into three parts: South Sulawesi, Southeastern Sulawesi, North Sulawesi. And those are political divisions. The city of Ujamhandam, up until like 4 years ago, I believe, was called Makassar. And they changed the name for several reasons. One was so they could extend the boundaries. So the boundaries are now like this, all of the cities here. It's the largest city in eastern Indonesia, and yet it has less than 100,000 people. Less than 1 million people. The old campus is located about here. The new campus is out here on the road toward the airport. It's basically a harbor city. Now, the reason I put the sign up is Ujamhandam, city of five dimensions. If you've been there, this would be the biggest joke you can imagine. It is a harbor, as I said, so you see many of the sailing ships there, even some of the smaller ones. People loading them. And it's been a harbor for many years for the rusty buckets of port. And there are times when it's incredibly beautiful. This incidentally is a Japanese ship coming in to pick up rice flour. And as seen from a restaurant on the harbor. The harbor itself, as far as I've said, the pedestrian portion, has a small seawall for what reason? But along the walkway, as you can see here, it's relatively nice. And you find people fishing there. This guy's fishing for shrimp about the size of a pencil eraser. And one of the things that Ujamhandam is known for, in fact, probably the only thing it's known for, is this old fort, which is a combination Portuguese and Dutch. The Portuguese built a wall around it, the Dutch many years later built the walls inside. It has been renovated, a portion of it has. There's also an excellent museum in the fort, and some of it honestly has not been renovated. Now you come one street off the scene along the bay, and this is what you see. This is the major shopping street that Ujamhandam. And while it doesn't appear so, there's incredibly nice shops in the street. Normally, this is the way the sidewalk looks when you usually walk in the street. And the kinds of things you see along there are just unbelievable. I have no idea what they were going to do with these. And there are obviously small streets going off to the side. This is for Game 75. Interesting thing here, you notice the canvas. Restaurant.
It'll hold about five people.
And it's a specialty restaurant. Rice and chicken or something like that. This is one of the nicer shops. And this is a street in another section. Now, we were there during the dry season, but the streets were always like this. Basket shop. This is an interesting thing. This is one of the main times I really wanted a movie camera. This ball that the guy is kicking is made of bamboo. It's hollow, extremely lightweight. And what they do is just kick it around without ever touching it. What they can do with it, movie theaters in that day. Bruce Lee and Charles Bronson, all of those guys are real people. There are a lot of movies that show over there that we don't get here. And someone after I got back, how did it come about? It seems what they do is they take the scraps, the cuttings from movies that are shown in this country, put all the scraps together and make them. A typical vendor that goes from door to door. Another one. This is a three-wheel bicycle with all that metal on top of it. That's Susan, for those of you that don't know. And that's interesting. Susan is a normal-sized person, but you see that page is awfully small. You have three Indonesians. Ride them very comfortably. One day, Susan and I got in one together, and we didn't go two blocks until there were at least 50 people riding around us, just laughing like hell. Seeing these two weirdos. For those of you that have never seen a mangrove growing, that's what it is. I'm sorry, not a mangrove. Mango. Thank you. Mango. They're really neat the way they hang on the strings. These are very young. They get much bigger than that before they arrive. This is looking out the one window of our hotel in Ujung Pandang. On the other side of the hotel was a soccer field. Soccer is incredibly big. Give an example of how big it is. International television in Indonesia. There's only one television company. It's in Jakarta. And yet it's piped all over Indonesia. We get television almost anywhere. But every day the television shows run from about 6 o'clock until 10:30 at night. That's it. Except if there's a soccer match on. And when there's a soccer match on, it doesn't matter what time. 3 in the morning or whatever. It's on the television. The president can make a speech, it shows up between 6 and 10:30. Soccer match, whenever it's on, it's on. So soccer's big. You'll notice in the background, on the other side of the field there, those trees are rain trees. And every morning when we woke up, this is the kind of thing we saw. The other interesting thing about being on the equator is you can set your watch by the sun at precisely 6 o'clock. And it doesn't deviate. That's the way it is every day. Anyway, this is the kind of thing we woke up to each morning. Some of the older buildings in Ujung Pandang, this is a court building built by the Dutch, still used as a court. Some of the housing, some of the better housing. Throughout Indonesia, there is this series of little ditches that run along each side of the road. What that is an open sewer. While it's very nice in the photograph, you're missing the smell. So they're really awful. And yet, unfortunately, people bathe in them, wash their clothes in them. It's really sickening to witness. Incidentally, if any of you have questions, I know I'm going very quickly here, but if any of you have questions, any of you have questions, for God's sake, ask while we proceed. That's about the only way you can go. The natives that do travel mostly fly, with rare exception, for instance, Hari, which is a city here that can ferry over to Kalimantan. I wouldn't get on the ferry though, because it's a nice ship, there's nothing wrong with it, but by the time they load it and leave the harbor, there's so many people on it, it's worse than that ship full of timber. I mean, it's down through the waterline full of people. Anyway, more houses. Some of these are quite nice, I mean.
Are they all Dutch built?
Yes, all of these are Dutch. You'll see some.
What's the material in there for it? Concrete?
It's almost all brick, concrete, and stucco.
What's the roof?
The roof in this case is tile. Now, Indonesia was a colony of Holland for young men's coming here.
Are they quite old buildings then?
Oh, they vary anywhere from turn of the century to late 40s.
Do the Indo-Chinese live in these buildings or are they the wealthy ones that live in them? Do they have different houses for them?
I don't know what you mean by Indo-Chinese.
Well, the natives, I guess.
The natives are Indonesians.
Yeah, what is that?
Indonesians are, I suppose you would say, from the Malaysian strain.
Are Chinese, perhaps?
No, they came from the other direction, from what the anthropologists have determined.
Are they intermarried with the Dutch?
Very, very so. It does happen, but not. In fact, there aren't any Dutch there to speak of anymore. They were all kicked out in the literally.
I wonder about that. I wonder, are they under, were the fighting wars, are they close to their, were the fighting wars?
Vietnam, the Vietnamese peninsula is not too far north, correct?
Would they be the same race or like Vietnamese?
No. You'll see in a moment some of the Indonesian fields. You'll see that they're considerably different. This is an Aryan giant ostrich. It's in here because we show these slides to other people, and the thing attacked Susan. The guy in the pen to take a photograph of it. And it was funny, and yet it wasn't, because an Indonesian went in with her, and the bird attacked him first, cut his leg. Fortunately, she got out with just a bruise. If the bird stands up straight, he can look me in the eye. The person on the left is our driver and his father. If you look closely, the older gentleman has on a pair of boxer shorts, which is very common for people to wear around there. And it's very curious. This guy owns a tobacco processing plant and a furniture company. He has probably 300 people working for him, no telling how much money he has, and he runs around a pair of boxes. This is possibly the university, the existing one. Unfortunately, this slide is very dark. Most of these buildings were built in this is their agricultural department. Most of these buildings were built in the mid-50s. This is engineering, college of engineering. In the background, and I must point this out to you, in the background, if you look closely, you'll see right about here a mark. About two-thirds of the existing campus is in a swamp, so in the rainy season, the water is literally about 8 inches high in all classrooms. So everybody comes with rubber boots on and they use wade around in class. You wonder how it ever happened, but here, there it is. The other thing is the roof material. Some tile was pointed out earlier. This roof material is called Sarat. What it is ironwood. It's the kind of shingle that is roughly about 3 inches wide and about 36 inches long. And it's laid in layers so that at every point on the roof you have somewhere in the range of 1 inch thick of ironwood. These roofs last forever, literally, if they're put down there. This is a poultry department.
How many students are there now?
8,000.
Are they mainly from Sulawesi?
Mostly from South Sulawesi, although a lot of students from other places. This building is a dormitory built out on the new campus. Politics being what they are everywhere in the world, to get this thing really going, the local governor donated this building. It's been sitting there 2 years, no one's ever lived in it. In fact, that's the only building out there. But it was done to show the Asian Development Bank they were really serious about building a new university. It's surrounded by Kampong and some of the poorest people that we saw anywhere. This is what most of the people outside the city live in. A Chinese graveyard, important for this reason. Sulawesi is known for having a lot of antique Chinese porcelain. Most of it comes out of the graves, dug up, sold in the shops, and you happily go down to the airport, the police take it away from you, take it back to the shopkeeper, and it constantly goes in that cycle. Good business for everyone. This is in the lower section of the city along the river, a typical scene. Some of the typical housing there, the walls in this case are made of sago palm, which you'll see photographs. That's all it is, just palm leaves, nothing else. They don't worry about insulation all that much. Same area, bamboo being shipped down one of the rivers now. Bamboo is a very important product for all the Sulawesi. It's used for just about everything, scaffolding, furniture. Now this is the kind of scene you would expect to see on the river in Indonesia, right? But this is what you normally see. Everybody has a motorcycle. These are, unfortunately, some lepers. The leper hospital is in the back. Kids playing with tramp files. You do see this kind of thing. Water buffaloes are also critical to the economy. You see them everywhere in the water. Riding. Not a good little buffalo, you know. So many things are done by hand. Now, this guy is digging rocks out of the side of this mountain and bringing them down here, and these ladies, unfortunately, bad photographs, but what they're doing is taking a little hammer and breaking it into gravel. And these fellows are making it into a So if you think Indiana has potholes, you ain't seen nothing yet. You can imagine yourself that that wouldn't be a very good road, yet that's the way they're all made. These people are pounding rice flour. It's a tremendous thing that happens here. This boat-shaped container that has the rice in it has a tremendous hollow sound when it's beaten. And no matter how many people are pounding the rice, they do it in a certain kind of rhythm. Start hearing it about 4 in the morning, and it literally goes all day long, right after harvest time. This is a sawmill. In fact, this is a two-saw sawmill. Two guys on the top, two on the bottom, sawing along. It's a curious thing. This is out in the country. We drove up, we saw these people, we got out, and there was a school across the street. The second they saw us, they let the school out. I make fun. this does go on, Indonesia has a very sophisticated sawmill that cut wood the same way we do here. That gives you an idea of the size of the Indonesian people. Susan is 5'9". All of these people are considerably shorter. There are a whole sequence here on markets. I'd like to go through these very quickly. Options, things are brought to the market in the morning, various ways. All kinds of items. I mentioned that a person who saw the tobacco, this is the way they do it. The dark tubes there are bamboo. The tobacco is rolled, mixed with the secret formula, stuffed into the bamboo, and cooked. And they pull it out of the bamboo and set up this way. Our driver's father, his secret formula is so popular that he sells the tobacco all over Southeast Asia. These are goldfish, carp, one of the major items of the Indonesian diet. Coffee. And packing up to go home to market. Outside of Ujung Pandan, up in the mountains, about an hour away, is a little town called Molino, famous for two reasons. One is it's very cool. Second is the first negotiating session between the Indonesians and the Dutch took place here. It's a beautiful city, as you can see. Well, the city's not much, the surrounding us are a lot like this. Our driver and his family. I keep mentioning driver, I don't want to sound like that, but in Indonesia, you're not allowed to drive, except in Bali, you're permitted to drive in Bali, but even with an international driver's license, you can't drive in Indonesia, except in Bali, so you must have a driver's license. This is moving down to the tip of the peninsula to a place called Kasi. The side of that building is all sago palm, all the same color. It just happens to be the way the light's hitting it to get that pattern. Now, the ones you saw earlier, the same thing happens when the light's in the right direction. This is an evaporation field, salt water drawn in, evaporated, the salt stuck up, and sold in sago baskets, sago palm baskets. This is moving up from Ujung Pandang up to our place called Batu Marung, which is a national wildlife preserve. It's an interesting area because of the rock formations. They're similar in a lot of ways to southern China, in that the rocks come up right out of the ground as large dome shapes. Inside the park itself is a river that flows through with many waterfalls, this being one of the larger ones. We made the mistake of going there on a Sunday, at which time the place was literally packed.